My name is Leigh-Chantelle. I run a website called vivalavegan.net, and today I'm going to talk to you about veganism is more than just a diet. Now I'm just going to give you a bit of a background of my history. I've run my website for 10 years this year. I've been a vegan for almost 20 years in January. And I've been traveling around the past month or so with all the vegan events. So I've been giving a few talks at some of those. So I'm just going to go over a lot of different things today. And if you have any questions, I'm going to allow for some time at the end as well. So just if when I'm speaking you think about something you'd like to ask, keep it in your head and ask it at the end, please. So I've been vegan for 19 years in January, and 19 years ago, if someone said they were vegan to you, you would know what that meant. That would mean they were for the animals, they cared about animals, and they were pretty much like you. And that would mean they'd be a kindred spirit, you could meet them anywhere all over the world, you would know what that meant. And now I find if someone says to me that they're vegan, first I have to find out what that exactly means to them. Because it means so many more different things to people nowadays. For example, some people might be high carb, low fat vegan. Some people might be raw vegan. Some people might be no sugar vegan. Some people might be oil free, gluten free, paleo vegans. There's so many different terms nowadays. There's so many different things that people do as a vegan or believe as a vegan that are focused mostly on dietary and food issues. And I think that the movement is losing its core values and its core ethics because the mainstream media in particular has watered down the term veganism. They focus primarily on dietary and weight loss factors. And I just want to go over today about how veganism is much more than just these issues that in particular the mainstream media focuses on. So I might just start at the beginning, and the beginning for me is my vegan journey. My vegan journey started when I was vegetarian first. And I was in year 10 at school, and every Saturday night my family and I used to have a leg of lamb roast. And I knew that the part that I was consuming was a lamb because that was what it was called. But one day I asked my mum, what is this particular piece of meat that my sister and I really liked? And she said to me, it's the Achilles tendon. Now I look down at my own Achilles tendon and I looked over at the Achilles tendon I was about to consume. And I made that connection there and then, that day, of what is life, my own, and what was death that once was life that I was about to consume. And I could not eat red meat from that day forward. About a month or so after, my school, a few things might fly away, my school went on a camp for a month. So it was the city kids going into the country, doing farming sort of stuff, looking after the animals. And this was where we looked after some chickens and things like that. And then after that, I could not eat any chicken. And I was still eating some sea creatures at this time. And I learned more about what vegetarian was. And then I also learned about the dairy industry and the egg industry. In case you're not aware, in the egg industries, all male chicks are killed as soon as they're born, if they were meant to be for egg laying. So the female chickens are used and abused for as long as they can create eggs. And female chickens or other chickens are used and abused for their flesh for as long as their tiny little legs can carry the big weight that they have nowadays. I did not want to harm any animals. I did not want to consume anything whereby I would be causing any harm to animals. So when I learned about the egg industry, I became vegan. And also from the dairy industry perspective. Quite a few people still don't get this, which I find quite bizarre, but like all other animals, like us female humans, to produce milk, we need to have babies. So cows need to be producing babies to produce milk all the time. That means they get artificially inseminated against their will over and over until they cannot produce milk or babies like calves reveal. So when I found out about these things, and I didn't want to cause anyone any harm, I didn't want to hurt anyone, especially just for my own use and just for something to eat, that's when I became vegan. So I became vegan in 97, beginning of 97, and it was a bit harder then. We didn't have as many great things as we have now, and I actually had to give up a few things. I had to choose to give up ice cream. I had to choose to give up chocolate because we really didn't have those things back then. 10 years ago, I finished studying naturopathy, nutrition, and Western herbal medicine. And I started after I finished those studies by releasing a recipe calendar. A friend of mine from school came up with the name Viva la Vegan, and that's how my website began. And if you've been vegan for any short amount of time, it might be hard to think back for 20 years that when there just wasn't many vegan websites around. There wasn't that much vegan information available. There were a lot of groups like animal liberation societies and vegan vegetarian societies, but for blogs that focus primarily on some other things, including lifestyle, like I like to talk about makeup for example, and things that dealt with food or recipes or calendars, there just wasn't anything like that. So over the years, my website vivalavegan.net grew into an online vegan community. There's recipes, there's articles, interviews, blogs, videos, podcasts, ebooks, print books, and there's much more. I'm actually here today to talk about one of my upcoming books, which is a vegan athlete's book. And a couple of the guys are in the audience now, actually, Nick and Bill. And so I've compiled this with 111 vegan athletes from all over the world, from many different disciplines, and 340 pages. I'm currently getting funding on Kickstarter for that, so I'd love your help if you can give any money to it or if you can promote it for me. I've got some cards here, and check out veganathletesbook.com for more information. So this year, the 10th anniversary of my website, I'm about to relaunch it, and I'm going to relaunch it with a new and improved website. So that's currently happening at the moment, and I'll get onto that after the crowdfunding finishes and after I get home to Brisbane. So over the past 20 years, there's been many changes. And like I said before, we really didn't have many options for vegan food at the time. I think, you know, we had one type of soy milk at the supermarket, and we didn't have any chocolate. So it would be really exciting if you went to a health food store and you found dark chocolate or carob chocolate. That was the most exciting things that would happen in your life when you were vegan back then. And nowadays, it's so great to see that there's so many different products, businesses, shops, restaurants. It's so much easier for someone to be vegan, and it's really, really easy for people to stay vegan. So in the last, say, 3 to 5 years, I've really noticed how much the use of the word vegan is being used in mainstream media. Have people noticed that? Like, it's really quite across the board, and many different people are talking about it. So, but most of this information is focused on what people eat or do not eat. So it can be about weight loss and certain food terms. For example, have you heard of raw till 4, high carb, low fat vegan, paleo? There's all these different food terms that are coming out at the moment. And I think instead instead of using the term vegan in the mainstream media for some of these, the term plant-based should be used more. Now, I fully understand that words and language and meanings change over time. But I know for myself, it's really hard to know that sometimes I have way more in common with someone who's a meat eater but who's really into social justice issues than someone who's a vegan but they're just doing it to lose weight. I find that really hard nowadays. Now, in case you didn't know, a vegan is someone who does not consume any animal flesh, and this includes sea creatures. A vegan is someone who does not consume any secretions from animals. This includes dairy. A vegan is someone who does not consume any products from animals. For example, honey or gelatine byproducts, and products from animals like eggs. But like I said, it's not just a diet. There are other non-dietary things to also think about, and if you're not aware of these, I'd really like for you to do your own research about them. One of the things is clothing. So as a vegan, most people would not wear clothing that comes from animals. For example, wool, silk, or leather. There's cosmetics and household goods that as vegans you would not support or would not buy. These can be things that don't have animal products in them. So some examples of animal products would be lanolin or beeswax. And also, you would be very aware of things that are not tested on animals. And also keep in mind, as a vegan, you would want your money to go to things that you agree with and not things that you disagree with. This can be events, places, and companies. And so if there's a company or an event that actually has an event, or what they do as a company is exploiting animals, then as a vegan you would have a problem with that. So this, some examples of that would be like zoos, circuses, aquariums, rodeos. And veganism is a set of ethical guidelines that myself and many others choose to commit to. It's my way of leading by example to promote peace, love, and compassion to the world. And there's many, many reasons to go vegan. Lots of you know about the health aspects, dietary aspects, weight loss aspects, etc. There's also so many benefits from an environmental perspective. If you think about the amount of energy and water that goes into producing animal products, even just think about, you know, having lighting in an abattoir, having the machinery to make things work, having refrigeration to get the animals somewhere else, having the packaging, transportation, and then putting it in a fridge. Just all those things add up to a lot of energy use. There's also some other reasons to go vegan, like labor and human rights issues, animal rights and ethics, that's why I went vegan, and feminism is also very important. So these are some reasons to go vegan, and I hope that if you don't know about these, that you do your own research so that these reasons can also help you stay vegan. And there's some really great studies that have been going around the past year or so that actually show more people stay vegan if they are vegan for ethical reasons. And this means that ethical reasons would be animal or outside of yourself. So not just dietary aspects, for example. But your main reason might change over time. It might evolve, and hopefully when people come to the vegan movement for a particular reason, they can learn about other things. To me, veganism encompasses everything that I believe in regards to consciousness raising, non-oppression, non-objectification, and anti-consumerism. These are all things I'm interested in. I went vegan primarily for animal rights, but I'm also interested in feminism, social justice issues, and environmentalism. I gave a talk in Canberra recently at the Living Dream Festival, and I talked about diet and ethics. In Sydney, I gave a more intersectionality-based talk on ethics beyond the plate. So I'd really encourage you to have a look on my Viva la Vegan YouTube channel and have a look at them. They're about half an hour each. I'll also be filming this, so if you've missed a few things or want to go over some things, feel free to look at that on YouTube within the next week, hopefully. And show your friends. Now, if you just heard a word I mentioned, I said intersectionality. You might not know what that means. So I'll just give you like a really basic explanation of it. Intersectionality means it links all social justice movements to each other, and it works within all these social justice issues so that we can make changes together. Some examples that intersectionality addresses include racism, sexism, speciesism, homophobia, ableism, and classism. If you're not sure what any of those meanings mean, please do your own research and find out. I think being vegan is a really great way of putting compassion into action and living in line with your beliefs by leading by example to show how you want our world to be. But to me, veganism is just one step. It's a really awesome step. It's a really positive step. But veganism is just one step. Vegans choose not to partake in the use, abuse, and exploitation of non-human animals for any reason. But I think more focus needs to be on things other than what we do and we don't eat. There are some really great groups doing some great work, and I personally don't agree 100% with any groups that exist. But you can always use what has already been created and share it with people. So for example, some people do some great undercover investigations that you could share. Some people have great fact sheets, recipes, interviews and videos. Make sure you check out all the stalls that are here today. There's some really great not-for-profits. There's some really great places that will really do with you helping out with them. And I'm here actually today with cruelty-free super, which is 100% vegan superannuation. I bet you never thought about that before. So there's many things you can think about that are maybe outside this little vegan diet square. I'd like to mention a few things that I'd really like for you to think about and to do your own research on. So I won't go into too much detail. You can see some of my talks about some of these things. Or ask a question at the end. But I just want you to think about how we can learn more, do better, and become better examples of compassion in action. So, for example, ask a few questions. The vegan diet focuses on four staples. So to be healthy, to get all your nutrients, you just need four things in a vegan diet. They are fruits and vegetables, nuts and seeds, whole grains, pulses, legumes, and beans. That's it. Pretty easy. Now, with the amount of not so healthy vegan foods that are now available, do you think that veganism still should be promoted as a healthy diet? That's one question. Here's another one. There's a lot more people who are becoming vegan as they're able to control their intake of certain foods and they're able to be quite restrictive with their diets. And these things are done under the guise of eating healthy. Now, what more can we all do to encourage others to be flexible and open to all types of vegan food? And what else can we do to encourage long-term commitment to the vegan lifestyle? And there are many environmental benefits to eating a vegan diet, but have you thought about where your vegan food comes from? What are the growing, producing, and packaging processes that are involved with the food you consume? And question would be, how far has your vegan packaged food travelled? What are the food miles? Do you support food security issues? Do you support organic, in season, non-genetically modified and locally grown produce? That's a good place to start. Humans are animals too. We forget this a lot. But unskilled and undocumented workers work in abattoirs and in horrible conditions with bad pay. As vegans, we're not supporting that. It doesn't matter, does it? But what about your vegan clothing or your vegan shoes? What about your favourite vegan brands? Do you know the ethics involved in the workplace and the production where these products are from? And do the people who make these items get paid a fair wage? And most of us here have privileges we can never really understand or we can never really appreciate, unless they're taken away from us. Keep in mind that some people cannot choose not to eat particular food. Keep in mind, some people can't afford to buy new vegan clothes or new vegan shoes. Some people can't access transportation to support vegan restaurants. Some people aren't actually mentally or physically able to help at protest demonstrations, stalls. It's important to be really mindful of these things and to exercise compassion. Judgment is really easy, especially when we all think we know what the right way to do things. I said in my talk in Sydney, and I really want to reiterate it because it's really important, we all have choices. Each one of us has choices. But some people have much better choices than others do. So, how can we promote veganism in the most inclusive way? Our way is not always the best way. How can we learn from other movements so that we can work better with each other? An example I love to give is like the LGBTQI community. So they're really great at getting allies. They're really great at getting people from outside their movement to get involved, to be active, to spread the word. I think that learning some tricks from them is a really great way to start. How do we make the space more inclusive for people that aren't vegan, aren't animal activists, but we really want them to help us spread the word? We really want to work together. How do we do that? And how can we do more to participate in other social justice issues and support their causes? How can we encourage others to support ours? At best, vegans were 1-2% of the community. We need to find out other people's passions and motivations and see how we can plant seeds of change. For example, if someone's interested in the environment, we can give them the facts on how a vegan diet is so much better. If they're interested in animals, they love their dog. Do you know how much a pig is like a dog? We could share them some information from some of the animal sanctuaries and the rescue. If people are into gardening, we can give them some information about veganic gardening. If people are interested in working out, you can send them some links about Robert Cheek, Billy Simmons, Ed Bauer, or get them my book. Vegans don't only care just about animals. Some people act like it. Some people do. But we really need to start acting like it. We need to learn more about each other and the world around us. All systems of oppression need to be changed. And I know there's a lot of information to take in. I know there's only 24 hours in a day. So start with the things that resonate with you the most. What are you most passionate about? What can you communicate in the best way? So this is where you should start. Start at that point. But aim to always learn more. Focus on the term more good and less harm. And especially online. People are horrible to each other online. And remember that, wrongly or rightly, you may be the only vegan that someone comes in contact with, whether it's online or in person. What you do and how you do it reflects the whole movement. So we need to really start acting like it. And in regards to that as well, I'd like to you to think about some other things. What language do you use when you're trying to promote veganism? Is it positive? Is it negative? Is it encouraging? Is it discouraging? Do you use racist language when you talk about other countries or cultures? For example, Japanese, dolphins, whaling. What about China and dog meat? What sort of words do you use when you're talking about these things? Do you use trigger words that might really upset someone? Some examples of that might be terms like slave, concentration camps, and rape. Focus on finding out what connects us with each other and not on the things we disagree with. Lead by example and be consistent. In my almost 20 years, that's probably the best lesson I can give people. Lead by example, be consistent, and be the best version of yourself you can be. Once you learn something, it can't be unlearned. You might be able to ignore it for a while, maybe quite a while, but little steps still get to the same direction. What works for you now might not in 3 years' time, and what works for you might not work for other people. Focus on encouragement instead of judgment. Focus on education and planting seeds instead of just trying to convert people. Remember, the best answer sometimes is just listening to someone. And remember, we are all made up of the same things, but we're not all the same. Always remember kindness, always remember compassion, and be the best vegan you can be. And let's start that from right now. If you'd like to find out any information about anything I've talked about, my other videos, articles, blogs, etc., see my website, vivalavegan.net. I'm also across all the social media channels, Facebook, Google+, YouTube, Pinterest, Instagram, and a lot of my podcasts are on SoundCloud, etc. And I'd love your help to promote my vegan athletes book. I've got some cards here as well. And I'd really like to hear some questions. So that's it from me. So the question was, what does veganism have to do with feminism? So if you think about some issues that feminists might find important, like human rights, feminism, like rights for their body and how they use their body, and so for cows, for example, cows that are used and abused and artificially inseminated all the time against their will, female cows, that's a big feminist issue. So they have no control over their reproduction whatsoever, that's a feminist. And also from, a male issue, like all the male chicks around us, so not just feminism, it's like about human rights. So cruelty-freesuper.com.au, I've got a stall over there next to Kyle from Ed's Mission, so there's some pamphlets and information there. It goes through the things that we do not test, like that we do not invest your money in. So it's testing on animals, live things like that. The majority of other superannuation companies do put your money in. So people don't understand, things that we're fighting for as a vegan every day, or we're making sure we put our money to good things instead of bad things. For most people, the money that you have in your super is the largest amount of money you have, and it's being invested in these things you probably would have issue about. And cruelty-free super is a good for humans, planet, and animals. So it covers all three, exactly, human rights as well. So other groups might focus on one or two of those. Well, I can't remember how many members we have at the moment. It's been going for 5 years though. And the people who started it have been doing it for 20 years in the UK, so they've had good success in the UK. Yeah. So I've just been asked about more information about environmental issues. It's a destruction on many levels, I personally think. From if you think about water, to the air, to the actual land. So many areas are cleared primarily for animals, to feed animals, to then feed us. So for protein. So for example, instead of getting protein from, say, for example, soybeans are good for protein. We're feeding animals soybeans, so the animals are consuming the soybeans that we could be consuming, and then we're eating the cows. And that just doesn't make sense, I don't think. And the processes, I've traveled a lot in the United States, and just to see the massive amounts of factory farms, they take up so much space. Just driving down, you see all this space just taken up by factory farms. It's horrible. And, you know, animals weren't meant to be, you know, used and abused continuously and on this such a large scale. And that's really affecting the world. It's affecting climate change. If you're into environmental issues, I really suggest you check a book out called This Changes Everything by Naomi Klein. It's really intense reading, but it's really good. It's really worthwhile. And it covers some things like human rights issues and other things as well. Yeah, that's a good point. So, yeah, veganism would definitely help people who are starving because, you know, instead of them using their land for Western cultures to graze animals on that are getting sent back to Western areas, they're able to create their own produce and their own soybeans, their own rice, things like that, and actually be able to feed their families again, you know, and be able to have clean water, you know, because there's a lot of waste and a lot of horrible things that goes into the environment from, you know, just creating animals to kill, or even leather is horrible industry, and the amount of stuff that happens in the waterways and that, because leather production is horrible. So there's just a few things. Lots of people have been poisoned. And to me also, this is, you know, it's not just being vegan, it's being aware of other things like, you know, using plastics, or, you know, what we do in a general sort of way. How are we trying to make a life footprint on the earth? What more could we learn about it? I don't know all the facts, I don't know all the figures. Some people are really good with that. So, yeah, just have a look online. Naomi Klein is the author. She wrote books, No Logo and The Shock Doctrine, which are also really amazing. And her book's called This Changes Everything. And if you're not into reading, there's also a documentary that goes along with that. So that might be an easier way, yeah. So I think it's thischangeseverything.org. Might get you there. Okay, well, I hope everyone's learned something new today, and I hope you all go around today, learn something new from each stand, and take what you've learned home, find out some more information, do your own research, let's spread the positivity, the vegan message to everyone we can. And come and have a look at my book and get a postcard. Thank you.